Welcome, everyone, to Knowledge You Can Count On, 10 Hidden Traps Your Clients Must Avoid in International Arbitration and Litigation, with our speaker, Mike Ehrenstein from Ehrenstein Sager. Mike is a member of the Abacus Advisory Board and a very active and engaging member. And his expertise is in litigation and a focus in international litigation. And he is based in Miami. And I was looking at his bio, and I didn't want to read a full bio, but I said, this is one of the most interesting bios I've read, so I'm just going to read an excerpt for it. As a true martial artist, Mike operates with disarming calm, confident in his ability to destroy when necessary, and content to be underestimated by adversaries with little actual trial experience. His martial arts background offers a philosophical and practical underpinning for trial work that one-dimensional litigators lack. He is the most courteous and yet most dangerous lawyer. If you are in the fight of your life, you want Mike on your side. And well, with that, I am going to turn it over.
With that very, thank you very much, Jessica. And with that very humble bio that I didn't write about myself, let's get started. So 10 hidden traps your clients must avoid in international litigation and arbitration. And why 10 and not 5 as advertised? Well, for two reasons. Number one, I'm not an accountant and I have difficulty counting. So I didn't know the difference between 5 and 10. And number two, more importantly, I like to try to deliver more than promised. So before we start going through, I only have 6 or 7 slides to go through, and I'm going to try to make this presentation short but powerful. Before we end up going into the meat of the slides, I want to just talk for 1 minute about why these traps and international arbitration and litigation are important. And really, why are they important? It's because this is what we do. Abacus is a worldwide organization. Abacus is an organization that is dedicated to the proposition that we are going to be linking up together so that our clients can end up doing business together and so that we can do business together. Now, it's not only the reason for the existence of Abacus, it is a driving force. The internationalization of commerce has become really a driving force in the global economy. And 99% of these transactions work out fine. The ones that don't generally can be negotiated in an acceptable way. But every once in a while, one of these transactions blows up and it turns into a major, major headache. So that headache can become a huge distraction for your clients, and unnecessarily so. So let's go to the first slide, which is just a reflection of some statistics, which demonstrate in a very narrow way that international arbitration litigation is on the rise. It's become a cottage industry. And if you look here at I have a polling question in the middle of my screen. I'm just going to slide it over a little bit. If you look here at the list of arbitral institutions between 2012 and 2019, just this partial list, it's not a complete list. It doesn't include, for example, JAMS. It doesn't include the American Arbitration Association and a host of others. But even this partial list almost doubled in 7 years, from 4,500 cases that were arbitrated to over 7,000 cases that were arbitrated. And it's continuing to increase. This doesn't include an assessment of all of the cases that were filed in courts in international litigation. Those court cases have also been on the rise. So partly it's because there have been improved efforts at cross-border enforcement and treaties. Partly it's because of political frictions and trade. Partly it's because there's litigation funders that are pushing litigation forward. But whatever the reason, it's clear that the frequency of international litigation and arbitration is increasing and will continue to grow, which means that it's going to continue to affect you and your clients. It is more and more likely that your clients are going to get drawn into an international dispute, which is no fun for anybody except me or for whoever the lawyers are. It is exceedingly expensive. It is frustrating. It is unpredictable. And it is a huge time suck and a huge distraction from the core mission of whatever your clients are doing. So what I'm hoping to be able to do today is help you in a very high and impactful way without spending a ton of time and a ton of money, include a few things in your clients' agreements that can really, really alleviate some of those pressures. So in addition to that beautiful introduction from Jessica, let me just tell you one or two things about myself and what I bring to this conversation. I've been litigating and arbitrating for 31 years. A major piece of my practice involves international litigation and arbitration here in Miami and around the world, from minor transactions that, you know, are general commercial transactions involving the sale of goods, to major representations of sovereign entities in monster contract disputes. And all of these international arbitrations and litigations have taught me that there is an enormous amount of time and effort wasted litigating over things other than the merits. So when your client ends up in an international arbitration or litigation, the one thing I want you to walk away from this conversation with is the Benjamin Franklin famous quote, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. If you spend a little bit of effort up front on your documentation, you can end up saving an enormous amount of time later on. What we're going to focus on is how to get the combatants in an arbitration or in a litigation to fight over the merits of the case. Who's right, who's wrong, who owes money to whom and why? Not to fight over the rules of engagement. Where are we going to fight? What rules are going to apply? What evidence is permitted? Who's the judge? Who's the arbitrator? All of that can be taken care of up front when you're negotiating the transaction. And so that's my theme today. I really want you to walk away from this with a low cost, high value clause that you can add to your client's commercial documents, whether it's a full-blown hefty contract or terms and conditions that are typed at the bottom of an invoice. So let's take a look at just a common transaction and think through some of the traps that are in this transaction, because nobody took the time to think ahead about a few tiny issues that can have a huge impact. This is an invoice. This is an invoice from a freight forwarder who was a subcontractor and was delivering goods and equipment from the United States to Puerto Rico after the big hurricane there a few years ago. And this one invoice was one of thousands. There were thousands of these invoices, and there were you know, literally hundreds of millions of dollars at issue. And it's just shocking to me and I hope it is to you, that the way this business was transacted was on a purchase order to invoice basis only. No overarching overriding contract. Hundreds of millions of dollars, purchase order, invoice. And so what we can see here is there's some goods, they're getting on picked up from Virginia and around a few other states around Virginia. They're being trucked over to a ship that was leaving Jacksonville. And from Jacksonville, those goods were transported to Puerto Rico. And of course, a payment dispute arose. Now you would think that's a pretty easy thing to resolve. Either you got the goods or you didn't. And if you got them, you have to pay for them, right? Well, not so simple, because rather than fighting over the merits of what was being, the merits of did you get them and should you pay for them, they spent an enormous amount of time in different courts fighting over which court should be making this decision. Should I be trying this case in Virginia? Should I be trying this case in Puerto Rico? And which law should apply? Should Puerto Rican law apply or should Virginia state law apply? That took up about $750,000 of attorney's fees and took up about 8 months of time before the decision was made, before we could get to the merits. What a waste and unnecessary. So what I'm going to show you now, hopefully, is a few essential and often overlooked choices that can be made, dealing with international disputes. So the first one is, if you're going to draft a dispute resolution clause, decide up front, who does that dispute resolution clause apply to? In the case of a buyer and a seller, it's pretty easy. Let me just turn this off. Sorry about that. There. In the case of a buyer and a seller, it's pretty easy. But in some cases, it's not so clear cut. Are you going to have the dispute resolution clause apply to successors of the parties? Or how about their agents and how about their employees? How about their directors and officers? How about their separate independent contractors? Are they supposed to be pulled into the dispute resolution clause that you've negotiated between the two of you? And if so, do you need them to sign off on it? Those are issues that have to be thought through up front. But if you do think it through up front, it makes your life a whole lot easier once there is a dispute. Choice of law, another major issue. So in international transactions, you know, you're going from between countries, and the laws of different countries can apply and they can conflict. So it's important to think through up front whether you want the law of one state or one country or the other to apply, because you'll end up with different results. A simple sentence included in your dispute resolution clause saying, we agree that the law of Puerto Rico, for example, is going to govern any disputes which arise under this agreement, saves the parties the heartache and delay and cost of having to litigate over choice of law issues later on. Choice of venue is another choice that can easily be made up front. If we have a fight, are we going to fight in New York, or are we going to fight in Miami? Are we going to fight in Puerto Rico, or are we going to fight in Germany? You get to make that choice, and you should make it thoughtfully based on where the most connection to the dispute is likely to be. And for example, I'm in the midst of litigating an issue right now in New York where I represent a foreign sovereign country that entered into contracts in their country for the provision of power turbines. And the contracts specifically say, in the event of a dispute, you have to litigate the dispute in that country. And that makes sense because that's where the contracts were negotiated, where they were executed, and where they had to be performed, and where very likely the most witnesses and the most documents related to the case are going to be. Of course, the plaintiff wanted to bring the case in New York because he wants to have a bite at U.S. law going against this sovereign country. And hopefully the court will end up enforcing the choice of venue clause. But it makes a huge difference. If you think about it up front, make that choice, then you don't have to litigate over it as much as you would if it's not made. Next, choice of forum. Are we gonna litigate this in court? Is that what we wanna do? Or do we wanna arbitrate? That's the decision that needs to be made. Now, when you're talking about a choice of forum, you should carefully consider the time, cost, and reliability and reviewability of that decision. So if you're in front of arbitrators, it's supposed to be better, faster, cheaper. But there's a countervailing theory that says, I've got to pay the arbitrators to do their work. That makes it a little more expensive. Whereas if I go to court, I have a judge and the taxpayers are paying the judge to do his job. So is it really cheaper? Don't know. Most cases, in most big commercial cases, I think it's cheaper to go with arbitration because the amount of discovery that is permitted is generally very narrowly circumscribed, whereas in court, you can go and get a lot more of it. Plus, in court, any decision that gets made is reviewable, whereas in arbitration, it's very narrowly reviewable. It's much more circumscribed. So you have the cost and the reviewability, and you have the confidentiality. Arbitrations generally tend to be confidential, and court proceedings are not. So you should think this through making the decision. Also, you have to think through which rules are going to apply. Remember all of those different arbitral institutions that we saw on the second slide? Every one of them has a different set of rules. And if you're going to choose to arbitrate, you want to choose the rules that are going to apply, and you can change those rules by agreement. So you can say, we're going to arbitrate in front of the American Arbitration Association, for example. But even though the American Arbitration Association rules don't require us to follow the federal rules of evidence when we're presenting evidence, you can say, well, we want to follow the federal rules of evidence for presentation of evidence. You can change those rules, so you should think that through a little bit upfront as well. Here's a good one. You have to choose who decides who decides. What does that mean? What that means is there is a question about whether the arbitrators can decide the scope of their own authority. If two parties end up in arbitration and one party says, wait, arbitrators, you don't have you might have the right to rule on this breach of contract issue, but you don't have the right to rule on this separate tort involving a third party. That's an issue that gets decided up front, the scope of the arbitrator's jurisdiction. So who decides that? Does the court decide the arbitrator's jurisdiction, or does the arbitrator decide the arbitrator's jurisdiction? And although this is a little bit in the weeds, there's a ton of conflicting case law that goes both ways. So rather than get sucked into that morass, it's very simple to just say it in your document. We have agreed that in the first instance, the arbitrators will decide the scope of their own authority. The next one is choose who is empowered to issue injunctions. A lot of times preliminary remedies are required in this type of international arbitration litigation. you have to be able to seize some asset. For example, I was doing one recently where there were turbines that were at issue and they had to be seized. So did the arbitrators have the authority to issue an injunction to seize those turbines so that they couldn't be taken away out of country? Or did that have to be done by a court? If you include a sentence in your terms and conditions about who can issue injunctions, it avoids a lot of problems later. Choose the seat. This is a very important one. What does that mean when you say choose the seat? It means choose the country or whose arbitral law is going to decide whether an arbitral award is confirmed and enforced. So arbitrators issue awards all the time. Sometimes they don't get paid right away. And when that happens, sometimes the other party takes that award to court and says, please turn this award into a final judgment so I can go use the process of law to collect what is owed to me pursuant to the award. And when that happens, the other side turns around and says, this court has no authority to confirm or not this award. And these are decisions that have enormous consequences. There's a very famous case out of Nigeria where the Nigerian government was sued on a contract for, provision of power-related services. And it went to arbitration in London. And the London arbitrators came back and said, yes, we're awarding $9 billion to the plaintiff. In the meantime, the courts in Nigeria had considered the issue and said, arbitrators do not have the authority to issue any ruling here because all of this relates to tax issues, which are not arbitrable under Nigerian law. So the Nigerian court says it's not enforceable, but the London court said, yeah, it is enforceable. This arbitral award for $9 billion is going to be enforced. So which one do you listen to? It's a conundrum that could have been easily avoided. The London court says they're going to enforce it because nobody objected to London being the seat of the arbitration when the arbitration process started. If the parties had agreed in their contract, as they should have, that Nigeria would be the seat of any arbitration, the result would have been hugely different. 9. Choose an advantageous framework for your damages in the event of a dispute. There are clauses that can be included in your agreements that limit damages and limit liability. For example, there can be a clause that says, we are only going to be liable for damages up to the value of the contract, but we are not going to be liable for any lost profits or other consequential damages. That's a limitation of damage clause. Very common and easy to include. And as a result, it makes the value of the case that's going to be arbitrated or litigated significantly smaller. The parties have less to fight over, and so it makes it easier to negotiate a resolution. Similarly, you can say, I'm only going to be liable in the event that you can demonstrate that there has been a gross misconduct, intentional misconduct on my part. If there's mere negligence, we aren't responsible. That's a limitation of liability. And that type of clause, similarly, really restricts the amount that could be available in one of these cases. And so it forces the parties to get very realistic very quickly, rather than spending millions of dollars, you know, fighting with each other. Last and most importantly, choose the right team. You know, Abacus has, I think now we have over 105 firm members. I think we have over 3,500 professionals. There isn't a niche of expertise that someone within our organization can't cover. If you are going to have clients that are engaged in international business transactions, spend the time and choose the right team member to help you, help your client draft some good language to protect them from all of the delay, cost, and expense associated with fighting over the rules of engagement rather than fighting over the merits. Choose the right team also means if you get sucked into litigation, find the right accountant. The right accountant who can end up helping you really either augment your damages or limit the damages that are being sought from you. You've got to have people that are available to you to do the damage analyses and valuations that are essential to this kind of work. Now, some of these cases are pretty straightforward. When you get to the merits, it's, you know, so-and-so didn't pay for this crane, or they paid, but the crane was defective and we need to, those kinds of issues, maybe you don't really need a damage expert. But let me tell you something, if you're representing Nigeria and there's a $9 billion claim being posted for lost profits for a project that never got off the ground, you know, you really want to have the right experts on your team. And we have those people in our organization. I'll just give you one example of the right team coming into play through Abacus, in my experience. I represent a different sovereign country. And this country was sued again on a power contract and sued in New York. The person, there's a team member who is a member of Abacus who has offices within that country and has relationships within that country that were brought to bear so that we can end up having boots on the ground information about exactly what's going on over there with respect to the claims that are being litigated over here. And the claims are being litigated in New York. So we also have a team member in New York who is a member of Abacus, who has a fabulous firm that acts as local counsel to make sure that when I'm up there advocating the position of this client, I'm not breaking any of their local rules or stepping on the toes of others in a, unintentionally, of course, or just being unfamiliar with sort of local practice. So the three of us have put together the right team for that case. And if that case ever goes to the point where there's going to be a merits decision, we are going to be pulling, you know, accounting damage analysis expertise from within our own ranks, within Abacus, because we have I have the greatest confidence in our teams. So those are my 10 essential and often overlooked choices which breed international disputes and which can be dealt with very easily. And here I will provide you with an example. Now, this is a dispute resolution clause which I made up on the fly when I was putting this slide together. And when I was doing it, I made certain choices just for purposes of the example. When you end up doing this for a client, you need to think through these choices a little bit in order to make sure that they fit for your client's, best fit your client's needs. But if you look at this, this is you know, 4 or 5 sentences, right? If you look at it, it addresses each of the first 8 items that were on our slide. So choose to whom the dispute resolution clause applies, right? The buyer and seller, for themselves, their officers, directors, agents, and assigns, but not for their independent contractors. Agree. That's the first piece. Who's governed by this agreement? Second, the second one was choose the law that's going to apply, right? Second one, the substantive laws, I numbered each of these according to the numbers on the side. The substantive laws of the state of Florida shall govern any and all claims and defenses which arise from or relate to this agreement, whether in contract or otherwise. Okay. Third, where is it going to take place? Choose the venue. It shall take place, the arbitration shall take place in the United Kingdom. Four, where is it going to be, by arbitration or litigation? Well, it's going to be by arbitration. We agree that we're going to resolve this exclusively, solely and exclusively through mandatory binding arbitration before the International Center of Settlement of Investment Disputes, the ICSID. And we agree that we're going to apply the rules of the ICSID in effect, as amended from time to time. So the first five are taken care of. The only three that remain are: who has the authority to decide the scope of the arbitrator's authority? In this agreement, we said, or in this clause, we said that the arbitrators, not the courts, shall have the authority to first decide the scope of their own jurisdiction. That one sentence is, if it were included in as a standard provision in all international litigation, in all international transactions, would avoid an enormous amount of litigation. This issue has been up and down to the Supreme Court at least three times that I can think of, and they've never ruled on it one way, in the United States, and they've never ruled on it one way or the other. And this is an issue that is a problem not just in the United States, it's a problem all over the place. So if you include that clause in there, it's very, very, very helpful. Similarly, in this clause, we've decided that the arbitrators and not the courts are empowered to grant precautionary, preliminary, or injunctive relief. If they need to grab something or enjoin some kind of misconduct, the arbitrators can do that. Now, if you're going to say that, you might want to be careful and just make sure that what you're saying in terms of the arbitrator's authority to grant injunctive relief is consistent with the applicable rules of the arbitral body. Sometimes most arbitral rules permit it. There are a few jurisdictions where if you go to a court, which require you go to the court in order to obtain that type of relief, and there's a lot of confusion over whether, if you go to court to obtain injunctive relief, whether that ends up working a waiver of the right to arbitrate. So you got to be a little careful there. And then finally, where's the seat? In this case, we've said Miami is the seat of the arbitration, and any challenges to arbitration procedure or award shall take place solely and exclusively in Miami, Florida, and applying the arbitral laws of the state of Florida. So in the last 45 minutes, what I hope to have accomplished was to give you a little bit of information, that ounce of prevention that could be more than a pound of cure, to prevent your, to help you help your clients avoid getting sucked into the black hole of needless litigation over procedure, and needless litigation over the rules of engagement, rather than litigation or arbitration over the merits. Now, I'm one of those strange guys that actually not only does this for a living, but I actually get a kick out of it. So I'm always available to discuss this stuff with anybody at any time. If you have any questions today, I'm happy to listen and try to give you an answer. If you have any questions that come up for clients and you want to run through some ideas, I'm happy to talk to anybody anytime. Thank you very much for your attention. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Mike. That was very informative, and I think that some really good tips for everybody on both sides, legal and accounting. And I like that you really pointed out the opportunities for the Abacus members to work together to be proactive in helping their clients, and also if they're run into any issues, to be able to serve them. Does anybody have any questions for Mike? I know you're, if a few of you are on mute, you don't have to be shy.
I see Gunter has his hand up.
Yeah, hello. Hi, I would just thank you very much for your explanations. That was very helpful, I believe. I just, being from Europe, I have another issue, which is the language of the arbitration, because it's very complicated. Sometimes you have, even if you have two whatever Spanish speaking parties, that might all everything might be in English or vice versa. So do you believe it's useful to include something?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So I had an arbitration involving a cement production facility from the Dominican Republic. I spoke no Spanish when this arbitration started. By the time this arbitration was over, 3 years and millions of dollars later, I had learned enough Spanish just from having been exposed to all of the documents and all of the witnesses that I could kind of get by a little bit. But it was a huge problem because the arbitration clause in that case required that arbitration take place in English in Miami before the AAA. But the entire transaction that was at issue took place in the Dominican Republic with non-English speaking participants, all with Dominican witnesses, Dominican documents, and ultimately it made it a problem. It made selection of the arbitrators even a little bit more challenging because you needed to have arbitrators that were sufficiently bilingual. And I guess not just bilingual, bicultural, to be able to understand what was going on. So yes, I think that's a great point, Gunther, that if you can, you should absolutely try to include a selection of language. It's a great suggestion.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Going once.
Hey, Mike, I actually have a question. You know, we do a lot of contracting with hotels and properties and stuff, and sometimes it's a little difficult to adjust some of these agreements because they are so set in stone. Either you take it or you leave it.
Right.
What do you suggest in something like that? Just, I mean, any suggestion, take it or leave it.
Yeah, listen, there's a certain amount of there's a certain amount of negotiating leverage that parties come to the process with. If you don't have the leverage to demand that these things get included or changed, then you don't have the leverage and you have a business decision to make about whether or not you want to do the deal or not. But my only suggestion otherwise would be if you're being told take it or leave it, make sure you know what you're accepting. If you're
sure.
Look, you know, we had an Abacus meeting in Singapore, and we're gonna have one coming up in Lisbon, right? I'm sure that it would be very difficult to convince the hotel from Singapore or the hotel from Lisbon that in the event of a dispute, you guys have to come all the way to Miami and fight with Mike Ehrenstein in my backyard. He's not going to do it.
Right.
At the same time, you better be sure that when you're signing their agreement that says, if there's a problem, you've got to come here to Singapore to fight with me, or you got to come to Lisbon to fight with me, that you have the resources there to understand what it is that you're agreeing to. So with
respect, well, one of the reasons we book meetings where we have members.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. That's exactly right. You want to be able to have somebody like Enrique in Lisbon take a hard look and make sure that you know what you're getting into, right? I mean,
yeah.
Listen, talk about a place with laws that are different than the laws that we're used to. I don't think that Singapore has a commercial equivalent to caning people, but if the penalty for graffiti in Singapore was caning a kid, maybe that there's significant, like I was saying before, when you're doing choice of law and choice of venue, there's significant differences between all these jurisdictions. So have somebody locally really tell you what you're getting into. And that's another thing that, look, that's another beautiful thing about Abacus. We have these relationships with each other all around the world. Somebody in our group is going to be able to tell you, Lisbon is going to be favorable for this, but unfavorable for that. Singapore is going to be great for this, but maybe not for that. They'll be able to give so that you go into this agreement with your eyes open. And you, Julio, are like an example of our typical international client. We all have clients that are buying and selling and providing services all around the world. We all do. And they all need to have that understanding. They need to go into their agreements with the best protection they can have from these, you know, 7 or 8 clauses, or 10 clauses, sorry, 9 clauses and 1 choose the right team. You need to have the best protection you can get by including or negotiating these clauses, or at a minimum, have some team member from Abacus in country telling you what you're getting into, so you know. Go in with your eyes wide open, right?
Thank you, Mike. Very, very, very good advice.
Okay.
Hi, Mike. I could have used you. I could have used you in the past in this session. Lots to think about. Rick,
I think has.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to thank you, Mike. I'm a CPA, so it's very busy this time of year, but the topic looks so good. I had to have you on the sides. Sorry, I wasn't sharing my screen as I was working away here, but it was very informative, very worthwhile. I think we might have had more CPA attendance if it had been after, at least in the US, May 17th, tough deadline.
Yeah.
But it's good to see you. Good to see the presentation. And we do a lot of international business, like you said, so it's good to know that there's a, you know, good resource out there with Abacus to turn to. So I appreciate that. And I look forward to meeting you in the future.
Absolutely. Well, I hope I'm going to see you in Lisbon.
But I hope so too, as well. Good. Yeah.
Good. Great.
I'm all vaccinated, so hopefully that'll be a go.
Thank you very much. And okay. You know, anything, if your international clients have any questions about any of this kind of stuff, like I said, I'm the nerd that likes to talk about it. So you can call me whatever you want.
No, that came through pretty clearly. So I appreciate that. Okay, that's very good. Yeah. All right. I got to get back to my work
here. Have a good one. Good luck with your tax deadlines. Bye.
Appreciate it. Okay. Thanks, everyone. I'll see you.